All right, the Oscars are this Sunday, and part of the tradition of the Oscars is we have the great, legendary movie critic Jeffrey Lyons on with us, and he joins us today on the phone. Jeffrey, how you doing?
Hi, Michael. I'm looking forward to seeing you in the upcoming season. It's been a very strange couple of days, what with Kobe Bryant and Mookie Betts and Kirk Douglas, a friend of my family's for 70 years, and now Oscar's coming up. It's been an interesting up and down emotional time.
Now, I'm hearing a rumor that you are actually going to be the Red Sox manager. They'll name you the manager in the next couple of days.
Okay, tell me what you think of this, guys. Don, you're here too, I suppose.
Sure, and Peter.
Let's say the commissioner has suspended Alex Cora for a year. Who's to say he can't come back? Because everybody loves him.
I think that's their play.
Yeah.
I really believe that's their play.
Wow, that'll be something. In the meantime, Jason Veritek is my new guy to succeed him, albeit temporarily.
All right, let's talk about Best Picture. Who do you like?
I think it's between 1917, which I loved, and my favorite film of the year, Once Upon a Time in Hollywood. But I think the vibe that I get is that it's going to be 1917. I don't know if you've seen it, but it's a sensational film. Did you see Once Upon a Time in Hollywood?
Yes, I did, and I liked it a lot.
I take back everything I've ever said about most of Quentin Tarantino's movies. I met Sharon Tate in London one time, and she appears in the movie, as you know, in that clip that Margot Robbie watches herself on screen.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And I was terrified of how the movie might end. Do I have to sit through a recreation? And it, as you know, I don't want to give anything away. It's the biggest surprise I have ever seen in the 30,000 movies I've seen. But I think the buzz is 1917. I don't think it's getting a lot of ratings because everybody's won a lot of almost all the preliminary awards, the ones I voted for, the Critics' Choice Awards, and every other SAG Awards. So it's I don't know if there's going to be much suspense this year.
I'm just curious about one thing. Sorry, Don. So I really enjoyed Once Upon a Time in Hollywood, but a lot of people, there are many people out there who thought it paled to compared to Tarantino's best work. You said it was almost the opposite for you. Why did you like it more than Tarantino's
previous work? Well, I lived through those times. And as I say, I met Sharon Tate, and I remember Hollywood being like that back then. And if you remember, the New York Times had a full-page dissection of how every single little thing in the film looked authentic, from the ads for the local news anchor.
Yeah.
On whom the character of Ted Baxter was based on the Mary Tyler Moore Show, and every little detail was done perfectly, and it just took me back to another time. And I think that two great performances from these I think Brad Pitt and Leonardo DiCaprio are the Burt Lancaster and Kirk Douglas of our age, parallel stars. De Niro and Pacino, Joan Crawford and Betty Davis. I love parallel stars who have similar careers coming up at the same time. So I loved a lot about it, and I just hope it wins. But I'm not sure it will.
Now, I know we're prisoners of the moment, but when I saw it, I thought, this is Tarantino's best work. And this is coming from somebody that loved Reservoir Dogs, loved Pulp Fiction. But doesn't it make sense that a guy 25 years later would be better at his craft? And it really seems like all of his experience came together in that one film.
Yeah, and you know what he said at the Critics' Choice? I think it's either the Critics' Choice or the SAG Awards. He said when he won for Best Screenplay, he said, I don't have to thank anybody. I wrote this all by myself.
Yeah, that was funny.
Now, I'm wondering about one thing. So The Irishman is nominated, and I know this is, maybe it's blasphemy. I think people are saying it's great just because it's Scorsese. I watched it. I wonder what ended up on the cutting room floor.
Nothing.
Was ridiculous.
Hitchcock said, tell it in 2 hours, and it's 3 hours and 40 minutes or so, and I'm not talking about watching it on Netflix. I'm talking about being in the theater, and anything over 2 hours, I usually expect Egyptian sandals, pyramids, chariots, gladiators, not wise guys popping each other in the brain again with guns. And even though De Niro's mother, I believe, is Irish-American, he has defined his career as an Italian-American actor, and he speaks Italian in the movie. I never for a second thought he was Irish, and I also don't care about Jimmy Hoffa anymore. I mean, who cares about that? It's 20 years overdue.
Al Pacino's accent as Jimmy Hoffa, it came in, it left. It was
nothing
terrible.
Like Jimmy Hoffa either. He got he became a caricature of himself.
This is a horrifying collection of takes all around. Phenomenal movie.
Jeffrey, I saw it twice. I loved it.
It's phenomenal.
And maybe the reason I loved it is because maybe we're different ages. I never really felt like I ever understood or knew the Hoffa story.
Yeah,
so
me too.
I kind of got caught up in that a little bit more just because I thought the Hoffa movie with Jack Nicholson didn't do it justice at all. I thought this one did.
if you can't win a Golden Globe of any sort, what are your chances of winning an Oscar?
And I could understand that. This might also be prisoner of the moment, too, but I was talking to the guys. I finally got a chance to see The Joker. I don't know if I ever remember a performance quite as good as what Joaquin Phoenix gave.
I'm with you. You and I are 100%
simpatico. I was really blown away, and I know that was inspired by two different movies, Taxi Driver and Scorsese's movie, why am I dropping the ball, with Jerry Lewis.
Oh, yeah.
King of Comedy.
King of Comedy.
But I just
thought he captivated me. I thought he was I was blown away by the performance.
I didn't like the film because I didn't want to spend 2 hours with an insane person, but I think he's a lock to win the Oscar, and it's deservedly so. I think it takes somebody who's part crazy to play a crazy person sometimes, because unless he's doing a whole gig on Us, he comes across as somebody who's unpredictable and loony, and that whole thing in the staircase up in the Bronx was brilliant. He did it so well, and he's a lock. He's won every preliminary award. I think it's hands down.
Do you know, Jeffrey, that I spend 4 hours a day with a lunatic? You can decide whether it's Don or Peter.
He's talking about me.
Yeah.
Okay.
Now, real quick, I felt the entire season of awards snubbed Adam Sandler in Uncut Gems.
You can't nominate everybody. How about John Lithgow for Bombshell as Roger Ailes? He was brilliant. You can't nominate everybody.
But here's my question. Banderas was the name that kind of popped up during the award season that, at least as a casual fan, I wasn't aware that movie was that great. Was Banderas that great in Pain and Glory?
I'm the biggest fan of Pedro Almodovar. I speak his dialect of Spanish fluently. And Antonio Banderas is an old friend of mine. I did the first one of the first English language interviews with him, and I know the towns where he would be a street actor. And I like Banderas's work in anything he does, just about. But I thought Almodovar's movies about women are great. This one didn't hold my interest at all, and it's got Penelope Cruz in. I did a first English language interview with her, and I've stayed in touch with them, and I'm connected to them. I like to feel that way anyway, and I just didn't get into it. I didn't care about his life. Maybe I should have, but I wanted to make more movies about women. Nobody does it better, so I don't think he has a chance to win, although you can always give somebody an award for their career, but he's not old enough for that. That's why John Wayne won late in his life. It was for his whole career. It wasn't necessarily for playing Rooster Cogburn.
Talking with the legendary film critic Jeffrey Lyons, the Oscars are this Sunday. Actress in a leading role. Jody and I sat down and watched Judy the other day, and Renee Zellweger was just unbelievable. I mean, I would think it's a slam dunk, right?
Exactly. She's won every award up to this. I saw Judy Garland live, and my dad knew her. I never met her, but I saw her live, and my dad told me certain characteristics about her, and Renee Zellweger recreated those perfectly. She was marvelous in it. She was born to play the role. You just forget that it's Judy Garland. You know who I did know? I know the guy who was her last husband. He used to be a maitre d' at Arthur, Sybil Burton's discotheque, as they were called back then, and I used to see him every night, and this was the guy who was her fourth husband, and it didn't last very long, as you know, if you've seen the movie. She was born to play the role. She was great in it.
And how about the supporting actress?
Supporting actress, I think Laura Dern's won everything, and she's going to be a sweep in it, too. She was great. All the performances were good. There are a couple of other snubs. Greta Gerwig should have been nominated for Best Director for Little Women. I am not the intended audience for Little Women, and it is such a sweet movie, and it's put a completely new take on the movie, which has been made about 6 or 7 times before. And I think Brad Pitt's going to win for Once Upon a Time in Hollywood. He's overdue. He was great. He exposed a weak side of his character, and the fight with Bruce Lee is enough to do that. You know, when I have to we take a family picture, and I want to put a fake smile on, I think of Bruce Lee being slammed against the car door, and I can't stop laughing.
Is it true that the Lee family had a problem with that scene?
Oh, yes, they did. And you can't, you know, the law, at least the law in this country, says you cannot defame a dead person. You can say whatever you want about a dead person. But they didn't defame him. I thought they brought back his memory. I thought it was fine.
It was funny. I didn't get a chance to see it. I desperately want to, but what did you think of Tom Hanks, and does he have a chance at the supporting role?
No, he's got, what does he have, 12 Oscars or something? It seems he's the male Meryl Streep, but he was fine. I thought he was a lead, actually, because he's the one that was in all the ads.
Yep.
And I thought he was fine and tender and remarkably well cast. And he's also related to Mr. Rogers. He's a distant relative of his, incidentally. So he was born to play that role, too. But I think he's not over. He has his Oscars. Brad Pitt does not.
Now, before I let you go, I love that Netflix exists. I just don't think that they should use the little okie dokie on us to put The Irishman in theaters for a month to get it nominated for an Academy Award. I don't think that's fair. I mean, there's Netflix and there's not.
Right. The good thing is that they bought the Paris Theater next to the Plaza Hotel here in New York, and it's a magnificent theater. Movies used to play there for a year, and they're showing that's the rule. I said to my son, do you think we're going to have movie theaters 50 years from now? Will everything be on Netflix and Amazon and all that? It's a great time to be an actor. There's plenty of work out there. He said yes, because you can't take a date to the living room to watch something. It's going to become more of a date.
You sure can.
The date ends, Peter.
Oh, sorry.
Yeah. So you're looking forward to this Sunday, right, Jeffrey?
Well,
you like this
I look
day.
At the Oscars as the toll booth through which I have to pass to get to baseball. So in that sense, I am, even though Mookie Betts is gone, at least for this year.
That's right. They could bring him back.
He told Big Papi he doesn't want to leave. I guess the Red Sox made him an offer, and he didn't want to scrape by on $600,000 a week. Can you blame him?
No, not when you think you could get $1 million a week.
What's the difference? How does that extra money make
That's
your life
That's how they keep score.
Different?
Yeah.
Oh, for goodness sake. He could have been the next, you know, Yastrzemski almost if he'd stayed out. He's not a big guy. Didn't have a great year last year, as you guys know. He had a pretty good year. But it's Chaim Bloom is taking a lot of heat. But they have the smallest stadium. They have 35,000 people and the highest prices they had to keep under the salary cap. It's going to be a tough year.
Well, he should not take the heat, though, Jeffrey, because the marching orders came from John Henry.
Of course. And John Henry knows what he's doing. And if there are a couple of down years, the Yankees have had them. To you got to regroup, I guess. I just hope I'm wrong, and I hope they win on the field and not on paper.
Good stuff, Jeffrey. Thank you for joining us.
Thanks,
we always
Jeffrey.
Love this
See
spot.
You guys soon. It's always an honor. Thanks.
All right. Thank you so much.